Okay. I would like to, if I would like to, you know, say that how rationals and real are with each other, you know, the term in Urdu that I like is like guttham guttha. They are guttham guttha with each other. So you can't say that, okay, you have a rational here and you know, and a next rational here. Okay, or maybe, okay, it's a pretty much abstract picture actually. Okay, so that's what we want to have next words. Okay, so you can think about the consequences of this property. Just think about it. That there are so many rational numbers, but still they are countable. And R is uncountable. Just think that how many real numbers would be there. Loads. Okay. One of the corollary of, I'd like to mention this corollary first, and then have to. One of the corollary of Archimedean property could be, should be, that if you have a positive number, then there exists a natural number n such that nx is bigger than 1. Okay? Can you see that why this would follow from directly? Yeah.
Y equals 1.
You just take y equal to 1. Okay. You can have this problem. So I'm going to use this basically. Yeah, so if nx is bigger than 1, then I can say that if x is positive, then I can find a natural number always such that x is bigger than 1 over n. Okay? That's what I can always find out. Okay? So I'd like to write a proof for this. Result, what do you think that from where we should begin? So I would like to begin with a consideration is that consider the multiples of n. Consider multiple of n. Okay? Like such kind of a set. Is this bounded?
Yes.
Is it bounded?
Just not.
So give me any y and I can cross it.
Yes.
So it's not bounded. That's what actually you are proving.
Yeah.
That this set is not bounded. Okay. You can always find a natural number. So it's like which you can multiply with x and exceed your chosen number 1. No matter what y is, I can always cross it. Okay? By a suitable. It's bounded. But why I'm writing it? We have already said it. So I should write direct proof. So, if x and y are real numbers, then trichotomy law tells us, then the picture, you know, may look like this. Either x is going to be here and y is here, or y is going to be here and x is here. So without loss of generality, assume that x is less than 1. Okay?
So why we are assuming that x is less than y? Isn't it given such that?
So I'm saying that, you know,
it's
quite natural. So x and y are in two real numbers. If it is given to us, it's fine. Mm-hmm. So if I have written proposition in this manner, okay, this picture makes sense. That's fine. Okay. So can I say that consider a natural number more better way would be to say choose a natural number n belongs to n such that 1 over n is smaller than y minus x. Do such natural numbers exist? So y minus x is a positive number. So by this, I can always find a natural number such that, you know, my that positive number is bigger than 1 over n. I don't have any problem with it. Okay. Now I would like to consider, so where could be 1 over n?
Sir,
it means 0 and 1, okay?
Before we start, x and y are from real numbers. So these both can be positive, negative, that case in one.
But
those cases.
But y minus x is a positive number.
Huh?
He's talking about positivity, right, I guess.
Uh-huh.
So y minus x is positive number.
No, I'm telling you, uh-huh. We are proving the result for all real numbers.
Yeah.
So when given to x and y, then x can be positive, y can be positive. So we are treating
yes, first the positive case, rest of the cases will become just corollary of it. I mean, what if both numbers are negative?
Mm.
Or one is negative, another is positive. That's not a big deal.
It is positive.
You can drive this. Just think about it. You can drive all those cases from here.
Mm.
Okay? You can drive all those cases from here. So where is going to be 1 over n? So it's going to be somewhere here, for example. So that's my 1 over n. Okay? What if I multiply this 1 over n with 2, actually? So what is going to happen? Where is going to be 2 over n then? So it's going to be somewhere here. How about if I multiply it with 3 over n? So in other words, I can keep on multiplying, you know, this 1 over n with some number, and I can actually get really fall into this interval, okay? So imagine, let M be the first, so this first is important, okay? M be the first, okay, natural number, such that M over N is bigger than X. Okay? My claim is this M over N must be less than Y.
Because
it's not because of first, but my claim is that you can always find such a. Okay? My claim is that M over N should be less than
1.
Okay.
Then this must be the cube, m upon n. Huh? M upon n will be.
That is going to be basically my rational number.
M upon n greater than this. M upon n greater than this.
Just think about it. So 1 over n is here, 2 over n is here, 3 over n is here. So I can get close and close and close and close to x.
But not greater than x.
And then there will be a natural number. Okay, that which I when multiply with 1 over n, I just fall into this interval. So I'm not in, okay, if there is a natural number, so just think about it. If m over n, so that you have two possibilities. Either m over n is going to be equal to x. If it is equal to x, then what we are looking for? Because that's a rational number. Is it making sense? Okay? So we want a rational number inside that, actually. Okay. So even if there is a rational number which is, you know, kind of equal to x, we'll ignore that and we'll we are only interested in that rational number. First such rational number which kind of a fall in this interval. Okay? So claim is this m over n is smaller than y. It can't go beyond y. So suppose contrary that, no, this is not the case. Gonna say that this would be a troublemaking thing. So suppose not. So if it is not, what does it mean?
Greater than equal.
Why?
M minus 1, or M over N is bigger than 1. Okay? Also, what you can say about M minus 1 or N and X?
Less than.
So it should be less than. Why? Because the M is the first one. Okay? And my claim is, now play with these both inequalities. If I multiply this inequality with negative 1, I'm going to have minus m over n less than negative y. Okay? And if I multiply this with minus 1, okay, we're going to have 1 minus m over n less than minus x. And I add it
greater than
minus x, and I add it to this equality. Mm-hmm. What's going to happen?
Y minus x
is
going to be greater than 1 upon n.
Greater than
1 upon n.
Is it going to be greater or
less than? It's
going to be less than 1 upon n. But you have just basically, so this should contradict this fact. Is it making sense?
Yes.
So just think about it, multiplying this with minus 1, and whatever inequality comes, add it here. So it's going to happen that 1 over n is bigger than y minus x. But abhi to kaha tha bhaiya ke 1 over n is less than y minus x. So contradiction. So how should I represent pi? What symbol should I make with contradiction? Like, okay, contradiction, confused. Okay. Alright, so you're going to treat this symbol as contradiction. Okay. So I'm not completing proof, just write it yourself, just think about it, why this should be.
Here x and y are not positive or negative.
Positive or?
Negative. What they actually are?
I think four conditions will be.
That's what we want to prove it, bhaiya.
Okay.
So we are saying that now my Q is this M over N. This M over N is my Q.
Sir, but we are proving for Q, right?
Uh-huh.
But it is known that X is less than Y.
Uh-huh. Yes.
So Y minus X must be positive.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
So it is for positive, I guess. Positive is
there. It is
positive. So positive what?
No, we can use that 1 upon n is less than y minus x thing.
For positive what, beta? I mean, if you have any two arbitrary real numbers, then one of them must be smaller than other, and you take their difference, the difference should be always positive. That's it. But those numbers are arbitrary.
Yes.
So there's no trouble. There is no trouble with x and y being negative or positive or whatever, you know, they are anything. But they are different as well. Making sense?
Yes, sir.
Okay? So, fun property. Okay? Crazy real numbers. Because, let's just think about it. Can you code such kind of a things? You have learned C++.
Code.
Your computer is going to break down. Yeah. You will keep on finding. If you have seen that movie, what you call Star Trek, old Star Trek. He has that crazy machine who can do all lots of things. And then you know, the owner of the machine decides that let's just try this machine. Okay? And he gives an order to the machine that compute pi. So when you read it, you will understand. Don't worry. Just sit in the back and you will understand. Okay? Is it making sense? So let's move ahead. Let's move ahead and let's talk about some of more properties of least upper bound. And then we'll talk about some new structures, complex and archaic, that will be easy. Okay, let's move ahead and deal with some more properties and reflect upon them that why those properties, which looks pretty much obvious, are true. Bound for a set R, A, okay. Then this is going to imply the one of the obvious things, okay, which is a part of definition, that A is less than or equal to gamma for all A in A. You agree with that? Trouble with it. So what does it say? That if gamma is least upper bound, then it must be a bound basically. Okay. The second thing, that if I have for all it belongs to A less than or equal to gamma, then this implies, what do you think that, what would be the if A is less than or equal to gamma for all A in A, then what would be the relationship between the supremum of A and gamma?
Less than or equal to gamma.
Gamma is less than or equal to
gamma? No.
No, that supremum.
This implies that supremum of A is less than or equal to gamma. Why? Because supremum is the least. So from here it follows that gamma is upper bound, and since the supremum is least upper bound, so it must be smaller than or equal to gamma. So it can attain gamma. Okay? So it's like, could be the case that gamma is itself a supremum, but could be something else. So something trivial. So these are kind of a consequences that you have to always keep in head, because some of these can be called at any time when we are doing the proofs and the features. So consider this case. If the gamma, okay. So I would like to write a statement which is slightly related with it. It's like, imagine if I have this. For all A in A, A is less than gamma, but this is strictly less than gamma. Now what would be the relationship between the supremum of A and gamma? This is very tempting. That, okay, since you have a strictness here, okay, so you might have a strictness here as well, but this is not the case actually. This should be less than or equal to, so it could be that, the supremum of A is
Yes, of course.
Equal to gamma. Why? is because that it's not necessary that supremum of A should be in A actually. It's not necessary that, so if it is, for example, the supremum of A is in A, then you know supremum of A is going to be strictly less than gamma. But if it is not in A, then gamma is something, you know, something outside A basically. Okay? So either supremum can be equal to gamma, fine. And it can be less than gamma as well. Okay? But if the supremum of A is less than gamma, is it necessary that supremum of A should be in A?
No.
That's also not necessary, okay? That's also not necessary.
Because gamma can be any upper bound.
Any upper bound. So, and supremum can be sufficiently away from.
Away from this, yes.
A. Okay, fine. You need to think about it. It's like thinking very carefully. How about this case? What if something is less than supremum? So if something is less than supremum,
long stay, then it is not an upper bound.
It is not an upper bound. So if gamma is less than supremum of A, so this would imply that there exists A in A such that so it's like A is greater than gamma.
Sir, you're taking contra positive or third.
I'm taking
contra positive or third.
Okay. Alright, so gamma is less than A. Okay. And can I put something here?
Supremum of A.
I can put supremum. Because A is always less than or equal to supremum. Okay? Like simple. So logical consequences of definition. So here is something which is slightly non-trivial. Okay, slightly non-trivial. So if A is subset of B, then what do you think that what would be the relationship between the supremum of A and supremum of B?
Less than or equal.
So what's a proof of this fact? I'd like to prove this fact. So what do you think that what should I do?
Assume alpha supremum of A, beta supremum of B.
There will be lots of ways. Uh-huh. The contradiction could be something easier. So assume that. So if not, then supremum of B or maybe supremum of A is bigger than supremum of B. What would be the relationship then? So what you can get from here? So one hint is that think about using the property number 4. So you have something which is smaller than supremum of A.
So there exists
A.
An element A in A.
A in A.
Such that.
Supremum of B is less than
A.
Supremum of B is less than
equal to supremum of A.
Okay. But why this is a troublemaking state?
A belongs to A, must belong to
A. Subset A.
So since A is in A, so it must be in B. So if it is in B, then it must be less than or equal to the supremum of B. But now you have found a number which is bigger than its supremum. That's a trouble making thing. Okay? That will be a contradiction to the fact that an element in a set cannot go beyond its supremum. Okay? This is bounded set. Okay? Cannot go beyond it. So I'm not finishing it, just giving you a kind of a so think about infimums in the same situation. What would be the relationship between infimums?
Infimum of A is greater than A.
This is something that you have to be careful.
Yes, sir.
A is subset of B, then infimum is greater than or equal to B. And think about justifying it. Okay? Not now, but you can think about it afterwards. Take it? Making sense? Good. So just be comfortable with supremums and infimums. This understanding of supremums and infimums is a very important factor. Have you started inner product spaces in your advanced linear algebra?
Okay.
If not, then you might have used this supremum and infimum in your topology.
Sure.
When you are doing metric spaces, I would. Of cuts. factor also deal with it. Okay? So enough of R, let's move ahead. Okay? So the next thing that I would like to move is either we can choose to do complex numbers, or we can choose to do basically Rn. You know, first doing Rn and then complex number would be, I guess, a more better idea.